the hand of the man who stilled the waters. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself. You can look at others differently by putting your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee.
Good afternoon. I am so glad to see you in the flesh. We've got quite a few guests, so let's share our mission with them. At Desert Hills Lutherans, individuals, but as a whole congregation, we are a people who love to celebrate grace. We love to make disciples. Starts with ourselves first, and then on the property, but especially once we leave the property, we love it whenever we can make a difference. So, to the guests, that's our mission, and I've got some announcements. Before I start the announcements, one thing was it was weird for me to record. So I was here, you know, the sermon was on the video, but I have to say, my new daughter-in-law thanked me probably, or thanked Julie and I, about 10 times for coming up to her party and for doing all of that. So you helped me score big points. Big points. Okay, cell phones off. The protocol has changed. Those two sections are still mask only. Everywhere else is optional. If you wish to wear a mask, please do. And if you don't, you don't. The majority look like you don't here, so wonderful. It's nice to see your faces. I just was told by Troy that Walmart is going to do the same thing. And so hopefully the whole is all going to open up. Okay. Offering boxes are still on the wall. Pretty soon we'll start talking about that. But for now, we won't take an offering, but the offering boxes are by the doors. Let's see. Tonight, the dinner is brat, sauerkraut, and German potato salad. That's what my wife says. I asked her if she wanted me to bring that home, and she said, oh, yes, yes. I'm going to score more points. Okay, we're continuing to collect gifts for the young woman, Amber, and her daughter, Tyam. Her husband was killed before their baby was born in a motorcycle accident. She's a young mother and certainly can use help. You can, if you'd like to give, it's just like a one-time gift for, and we'll deliver it, I think it will be in June. You just make out a check to Desert Hills and put Tyam, T-Y-A-M. It was, Tyson was his name, Amber is hers, so it was T-Y-A-M. And I think that's one of those things of it's really making a good difference. So the last thing is, and I'm just going to do this one because I like to. It's Armed Forces Day today. So I just want to see if any of you have served in any branch of the military, male or female, would you please stand? We thank you for your service. All right. Those are my announcements. Let me offer a word of prayer. Band's ready. I've been listening. You guys are ready. Yeah? Yeah? Lord Jesus, we know that life is not fair. But we know we can come before you in prayer when the unfairness of life gets us down. We pray for this time of worship and we pray for everyone here. In your name, Lord, we gather. Amen.
They tell me of a home far beyond the skies. They tell me of a home far away. They tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me of a home where my friends have gone. They tell me of that land far away, where the tree of life in eternal bloom sheds its fragrance through the unclouded day. Oh, of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. They tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me of the king in his beauty there. They tell me that mine eyes shall behold, where he sits on a throne that is whiter than snow, in the city that is made of gold. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. They tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrows away. They tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of unclouded day. Oh, the cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. I walked away from my Lord many times, searching for something that I'd never find. I couldn't see through the sun for the shine, 'cause what I was wanting was there all the time. And he never gave up believing in me. He kept believing that someday I'd see. Love was the reason he died on that cross. I found my Jesus and he wasn't even lost. I've tried the Lord's way of living before, but something was missing that I wanted more. I finally found what was missing was me. I turned back to Jesus, now my soul was free. And he never gave up believing in me. He kept believing that someday I'd see. Love was the reason he died on that cross. I found my Jesus and he wasn't even lost. Someday I'd see. Love was the reason he died on that cross. I found my Jesus and he wasn't even lost.
Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, who you are persecuting. But get up, enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought us safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
One of the great lessons of life is life isn't fair. Did you know that? Yes. It just isn't. Wise parents, that should be one of the first things you teach your kids or your grandkids. Life is not fair. Get over it. It's not fair. Disappointments abound. Do you know, I heard that, this is a statistic of that in the world, if you're born into poverty, the highest probability is you're going to die in poverty. That's not fair. It's not fair. Cancer happens, accidents happen, tornadoes happen, even people, evil people, just unfair things happen. And usually we don't holler if the unfairness is in our favor. Have you noticed that? Let me give you an example. If I order 2 pieces of chicken, and I get home and I've got 3 pieces of chicken, I march right back to that place and I say to them, "This is very unfair. I only paid for 2, you gave me 3. You believe that?
No.
Thank you. Just think of that. You all quick to respond that I wasn't honest. Okay, if I order 2 pieces of chicken and I get home and I have 1, oh, I get back in that car. Okay, I grew up with brothers and sisters. We were fairness fanatics. Fairness fanatics are, you better not get more presents than me. Your piece of cake better not be bigger than mine. You have to do the same work that I do. My eyes are on you. Did you have that in your house growing up with siblings?
Yes.
Fairness, I made that up. Fairness fanatics, measuring every single thing. Got my eye on you. Okay, so life isn't fair, but the kingdom of God is fair. Maybe. Let me give you 3 examples of people in the Bible, and after each one, I'm going to ask you, fair or unfair? So the first one is Stephen. Stephen is the first Christian martyr. His story is in the book of Acts. The first church fight in the Bible was a food fight. That's right, food fight. The Greek Christians got ticked off with the Jewish Christians because the Jewish Christians were taking better care of the Jewish widows than the Greek widows. And there was a church fight. Now, churches fight, so they had a fight. And so what they did is they picked 7 people to figure this problem out. And the first person they picked was Stephen. Now, Stephen was a Gentile who had converted to Judaism, and then he met Jesus. He came to believe in Jesus. So he was a Gentile, then he was Jewish, and then he followed Jesus. And he loved the Lord. And the thing that happened, though, is that the Jews just couldn't stand him because he kept talking about Jesus all the time. And finally, there was a mob, murdered him. Just murdered him. Stoned him to death. And as he's being stoned to death, he says, these are his last words. Lord, do not hold this sin against them. So he dies. He's the first martyr. He's a hero of the faith. He was a believer in Jesus. So he enters the kingdom of God. Fair or unfair?
Fair.
Seems fair. He's like a rock star. But the other thing that's very interesting, here he is, a believer in Jesus, and everybody thought very well of him. He talked about his faith, and he ends up getting murdered in a very short time. Life isn't fair. But kingdom of God, okay, here's second example. Let me tell you about someone who watched the murder. Somebody who watched the murder was a young man called Saul. He was a Pharisee. He was also a murderous zealot. He was a fanatic. So here he once said this, if anyone thinks he has reasons to put confidence in human goodness, I have more. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, of the Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. Then he goes on and he says, I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond any Jews of my own age and was extremely zealous for the traditions of our fathers. And he watched a young man being murdered and didn't do a thing. It's kind of like those, I talked about it in a sermon a while ago, the men that watched an older woman be beaten on the sidewalk right outside the glass doors in New York City. So Saul just watched him get murdered. Okay. In the Old Testament, if someone murders, your own life is forfeit. Okay, so right after the murder, he goes to the high priest in Jerusalem, Saul, and he wishes for letters so that he can go to Damascus to get other Christians, bring them back to Jerusalem so they can be executed. Okay. So on his way, Jesus met him. Now, was it fair? Was it fair that he got to have a visit from Jesus? Personal visit? Anybody have a personal visit from Jesus? Ooh, you got quiet there. Anyway, Saul's on the way. Suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. A voice said, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Well, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Get up, enter the city, and I'll tell you what to do. He was blinded. He goes into the city. We didn't read the part that is one of my favorite parts in the book of Acts. It's about Ananias, who lived in Damascus. And Jesus came to Ananias and said to him, I want you to go and speak to the man called Saul. And Ananias says, time out. Is this the guy that's killing Christians? Yes, it is. I think you should send my brother. No, I just made that up. He says, this isn't a good, he says, you go. So Ananias goes and he says, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the way here has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And what happened was Saul believed it was Jesus. He got up and was baptized, and the world was changed. He would later change his name from Saul to Paul. He would log more than 20,000 miles preaching and teaching and establishing churches all over that part of the world. He'd write one-third of the New Testament. He'd even be martyred like Stephen was. So when he dies, he's going to enter the kingdom. Fair or unfair? Now remember, he's a murderer. Wow, you guys are easy touches. Okay, third example. Third example is this one. I think you're gonna have to say unfair. I think. Luke 23. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Who are they talking about? Jesus. One of the criminals believed in God. He also believed that he was guilty and he deserved to die. He knew he was wrong, but he believed in God. But he was in a place of no hope. So he said to the other criminal, "We are punished justly, for we're getting what we deserve." So then act of desperation, he says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And then maybe three of the most important words in the New Testament. I'd never noticed this. I'd never noticed these three words. You know I like three things. I never noticed these three things. And here's the reason why. These are the three words. Jesus answered him. I suddenly realized as I was working on this, I worked on this a couple of weeks ago, that I said, do I believe that Jesus always answers our prayers? I do. I think anyone who prays to Jesus will get those three words will come true. Jesus answered him. Immediately, maybe not, but we'll always get that. Jesus answered him. So this guy was most likely a murderer and had spent his life doing God knows what, and God did know what it was. So Jesus answered him, those three words, and then Jesus said, "Where I'm going, you're going." He was executed. He got to go into the kingdom. Fair? Unfair? Have you no sense of justice? Unfair. He gets in at the last second. He gets to do anything he wants his entire life. He was awful. Stephen was a worshiper of God and he was martyred. Paul was, he turned his life over to Jesus, was baptized. He was shipwrecked, stoned, beaten, imprisoned, all of those things. Of course he'd go into the kingdom. But this guy, I don't think it's fair. It's better than fair. It's grace. That's the whole point of this thing. It isn't fair. It's grace. I think the gospel is perfectly unfair. And I think the kingdom is unfair. You can't stack it up. And God's going to do what God's going to do. Let me give you one last example. I know you know this one, but when I was looking at it, I thought, we got to do this one again. Matthew 20, the story about, and I did a sermon on this a while ago called The Benevolent Businessman. I called him The Benevolent Businessman. He owns a vineyard, big time. He goes out and he gets workers at 6 a.m., 9 a.m., 3 p.m., 5 p.m., He keeps going to get them. And he says, I'll pay you a fair wage. What is a fair wage? A fair wage is, I will pay you for the hours that you work. That's fair. What do you think? Isn't that fair?
I don't know. I'm afraid to even say anything anymore. You're just confusing the heck out of me. I feel like if I say one thing, you're going to say the next. My husband will speak now.
Don't look at me. I'm not going to. Okay, so a fair wage is you get paid for the time that you work. That's fair. So the workers, they do a 12-hour day. But some of the workers, the ones that came in at 9 and 3 and 5 o'clock, 1 hour before quitting time, they got extra chicken. And some of them got a lot of extra chicken. And the ones that didn't get, they were ticked off. They began to say that it was unfair. But God represents this businessman. And then he says this, I choose to give as I give. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? And if I want to be generous, I'm going to be generous. So everyone is invited into the kingdom. Everybody can meet the requirements because the requirements are to believe and be baptized. And the kingdom is open to the Stephens and the Pauls and the last minute criminals and even to you and me. Is it fair? No. It's grace. So here's the end thing. I realize it here. I think we need to get to a place where we're like God. God likes us to imitate him. I choose to give as I give, he said. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? And what he's talking about is generosity and grace. So, the assignment. The world out there is not fair. The assignment is to be more than fair, for all of us must bring the grace of God to people around us in word and deed. It's better than fair. It's grace. So this week, do something extra for someone. It can be your spouse, friend, neighbor. In fact, make sure you do it for your spouse. It would be a really good week for all of us. Extra. Grace. Amen.
Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. I'll speak your name every hour and help the blind to see. You've given me a voice and it will praise your name. As long as you give me strength, I'll help the lame, the ones the devil has in bondage. Help set them free. Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. I'll speak your name every hour and help the blind to see. Guidance too, and I'll know you'll be true as I am to you. With or without these eyes, God, let me see. Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. Use them well. Give me strength, don't let evil pull me in. Give me just enough life to be what you want me to be. Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. Lord, what more can I do? You've done so much for me. I'll speak your name every hour and help the blind to see.
Remain seated. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and we proclaim him Lord and Savior of the world. In Christ's name and by his grace, we accept our mission of witness and service to all people. We rejoice in God, maker of heaven and earth, and in God's covenant of love and grace, which binds us to God and to one another. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the very breath of God among us. He sustains us, guides us, and empowers us to be servants of God's love. We live as the body of Christ in the grace of forgiveness, the reality of the resurrection, and the light of eternal life. Amen. From Psalm 33, verses 11 and 12. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the thoughts of his heart to all generations. Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen as his heritage. Let us pray. We offer our thanks and prayers and gifts of time, talent, and treasure for your mission in the world to bring good news and help and hope for all people. We pray for members of our congregation. New to the prayer list is Beth Johnson, George Reek, and Jane Saunders. We continue our prayers for the 60 still on our prayer list, to all in need of healing. Lord, grant peace, comfort, healing, and hope. Lord, we pray for our country. We give thanks for the vaccines and their availability. We pray for the continued end of COVID and the end of lockdowns and masks. On this Armed Forces Day, we give thanks for all the men and women who have served in the military. We thank you and them for their service. Finally, Lord Jesus, we give thanks that we have been offered the kingdom through your self-giving on the cross, that as we believe, we are ushered immediately into your kingdom, even when it isn't fair. Help us walk through the next week as your disciples, making a difference. In your name we pray. Amen. Please rise now for the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May the blessings of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. There's little light in all of us by God's design. But you can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. May God's love surround you, may you find a brighter day. May he grant you the peace you seek in every way. God's light burns in each life, yours and mine. Yes, you can be a beacon if you'll just let it shine. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. There's little light in all of us by God's design. But you can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. You can be a beacon if you'll let it shine.
Go in peace and share the good news. We will. Thanks be to God.
You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. There's little light in all of us by God's design. But you can't be a beacon.